Okay.
Looking forward to your
Okay. We are live and I
Okay, everybody. Our last keynote speaker, quite late. Ladies and gentlemen, we are having lunch and the lunch lecture, and I'm happy that we could bring Mario Klingemann here. He's from Munich, so it sounds as if that is not so difficult, but he's a very busy man, and he will tell you a little bit about his projects in the last months and years, probably. And I think that will be a great inspiration. I'll just hand it over to you.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Well, thanks for having me. And so, I'm from Munich, and my talk is called The Joy of Order, but just now I felt the pain when order breaks down, because I thought, oh, I just get here and realized that the subway didn't work. And before that, I tried to clean up space on my machine and was watching the progress bar of it cleaning up for half an hour while the time was running out. But okay, I'm here. Let's go. Yes, so the joy of order. Well, you might wonder what that has to do with me, because I call myself a code artist, which means I'm creating art with the help of algorithms and data. So I do things like I write code, which then produces things that creates weird creatures or collages, or I find interesting things and find other ways to reassemble them in hopefully interesting ways as well. So this is a project called Ernst. But yes, what I am also is an obsessive compulsive orderer. And I hope you can see what comes next. So, because that kind of shows that it's almost clinical, because when I go on holiday and was at the beach, I saw this. And well, I'm usually not so, beaches are not so exciting for me, so I look for something to do. So I marked off this, I don't know, 4 square meters of the beach, and tried to figure out what's in it, and clean that. And I can recommend that process to everybody, because it's a really nice Zen-like experience. And yes, you take everything apart and see what it is it made of, and make these little data visualizations, you could say. So, and yes, of course, you also find other weird things in there. Now we come to that. And yes, so I always wondered, why am I, like, I order so much? And I think it's because in a way I'm a collector, and I have something in common with other people, especially train spotters, cat ladies, stamp collectors, and jigsaw puzzlers. And that is, we are all dopamine junkies. That is the secret about order. Because order is not so much about collecting things. It's not so much about making order. It's about that thrill when you find something that matches your collection. And it's kind of it's that reward system of the brain which works there. Whenever you find something that fits into whatever system you have made or order you have made, it gives you a little bit of dopamine, and that is kind of, yeah, that makes us, like, we are addicted to that stuff. So, of course, like, there's the question, like, how can I get more of that stuff? How can I discover more things? And unfortunately, we don't live in times like these where you could travel the world and still have the opportunity to maybe find dragons somewhere on a white spot on the map. Everything seems to be, has already been discovered. So traveling outside doesn't work anymore. But fortunately, now what we have is all these great data dumps in the internet, or let's say open data. And there is a place where you can still make discoveries. And for me, the first time I got into this was when the British Library had created this project called the Mechanical Curator, which was an automated tool that went through scans of book pages that, like, of I think it was about 50,000 books that had been randomly selected from a shelf. And I think back many years ago, Microsoft wanted to get into this field, so they had digitized all these pages for doing OCR text recognition on it. But what at the lab of the Bridget Library, what they figured out that in the metadata of these page scans or these OCR scans, there were also all these areas which said, like, not a text. And but they were delineated by cropping by areas. So they wrote a little bot which went again through all these scans and cut out all these areas, because what it was all the illustrations and images from all these books. And the great thing that they did was, it's over a million images, they uploaded it to Flickr and shared it in the public domain. And this was great. So when they initially uploaded it, you could just browse through this material and just discover interesting things. And sometimes you came across a beautiful image, and because Flickr shows how many people have seen that image already, wow, you could be the first to rediscover this beautiful image. So you had already this spirit of the explorer and discoverer. But there was a problem with this, because all these books were, in a way, randomly selected, and the machine was just cutting out the material. There was no metadata, really. I mean, not really a lot of metadata. So you could not just enter, okay, find me a seahorse into Flickr, and it would give you the seahorse. No, actually, the first thing you could do was just going image by image and hope that at one point you find something that you were looking for. And that, of course, triggered my interest. Is there a way to teach the machine to help me finding more of the stuff that I'm interested in? So I had already done a little bit of experiments with image analysis and these things. So I thought, okay, let's go. Because in a way, when you took the raw data, it looked a bit like that beach I showed you before. I mean, you see there's a lot of things. It's actually very beige too. And you see these certain patterns that stick out. Okay, there are portraits and there are, you know, maps maybe, decorative elements. So I thought, okay, maybe, well, how do I start? So for an earlier project, I had already tried to figure out kind of like what makes an image look like art. Because there is this difference between, like, you open up a newspaper, there's soccer photos, politics photos, and then there are photos where everybody says, oh yeah, that's art. So I thought there must be something, without having any context, you look at the image and it gives you kind of already kind of a rough category. And so I had already a image analysis tool which would give me back a feature vector, and it already worked pretty well with art. So I dressed through it in and then measured similarities, and it started to group me together similar things like still lives, landscapes, portraits. So, and that was kind of very, let's say, old school machine learning. I just used general features of an image like edges, histogram data. I treated the whole image like a texture, and that gave me 127 numbers, which is my feature vector. And with that, I could start trying my classification. So, of course, the first thing I had to do was download the whole stuff from Flickr and then run it through my homegrown analysis algorithm. And then I could, well, of course, I had to start with something and, like, tell the machine, okay, this, if a feature vector is like this, then it's probably a cat or a map. So I started very simply by just using the Explorer or Finder if you're on a Mac, and started initially really randomly creating new folder names and going through a bunch of random images and saying, okay, this is a portrait, this is another portrait, so they all go into the portrait folder, here's a map. And I just started a very kind of coarse ordering system. But then I could already start training on that. So saying, like, and in these days I was using R and Rattle, and so, and kind of, let's say, old school machine learning techniques like random forests and support vector machines. And but it already worked. So I gave it, I think initially, maybe 20 just rough categories, because that's, again, the thing, like, I worked on the beach. You first go for the easy things, the stuff that immediately falls into your eye, like the big stones or the portraits. And then further down the way, you can start going a little bit finer grained. But okay, so this is then what the machine said, like, okay, I think all these things are maps. And initially, so it would copy all these files to another folder, and I just go through them and decide, yes, 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 correct, correct. And then, of course, there are all these things which were not so correct. But with this additional training data, I could retrain the model, and it would get gradually better and better, and I would start splitting up categories. And, I mean, it does funny things, so here in the middle, the wonder thing, you thought, oh, yeah, that's a portrait. Well, not quite. So, okay, but the downside were, I mean, using support vector machine or random forest, it took a very long time to train it, and because I was only using these kind of global image features, it was not really, like, there were kind of categories where it was always wrong. But, okay, it was already a good start. But obviously, now, well, I don't use that anymore because deep learning has made all this so much easier. So I'm pretty sure you, in the past days, you have already kind of heard about it, but I guess just quickly go through this again. So deep learning is mainly about turning cats into data. So, of course, images of cats. And an image of a cat is already data, right? Every pixel of an image has already, is like a five-dimensional feature vector. No, I mean, a whole image is a huge feature vector, but every pixel has already five dimensions, the color value and its coordinate in the image itself. So, but of course, it's way too much information. So what these convolutional neural networks do is they kind of boil down all this information for us. So if we give it an image of a cat, in the end, we get out this category probability that says, yes, I see a cat. And if you look into these neural convolutional neural networks, it's actually bitmaps all the way down. And this is really not very to be seen on this, but it starts from this coarse, from this fine view where it just looks actually for edges and gradients and textures, similar in a way what I did with my earlier classifier, but deeper down it starts combining these activations into more abstract categories. And in the end, well, what you get is that feature vector, which is the magic thing, I would say. So let's ignore the other thing that's kind of more if you want to go artistic. But that layer, just before it tells you what categories it's really brilliant. Because what it is, it's pretty much an address in a multidimensional space where this image is located. And if you run this over 100,000 of images, what happens is that things that look similar will end up in the same area in that multidimensional space. And of course, so in this case, I don't know, on this 2D map, there will be the cats. Problem is, because it's a multidimensional space, some cats will also cluster here and there too, because maybe it clusters some, let's say, drawn cats in one area and photos of cats in another, and maybe there are cats that look a bit like dogs. So it's kind of this, these multidimensional spaces are not kind of, you cannot treat them like really like a 2D map.
What is the name of this multidimensional space?
We come to that. Okay. I mean, the name, the multidimensional space, I always call it the latent space. Because in a way, we don't really know what's going on there. We try to figure out the 2D thing, and I come to that in a second. Because, yes, how do you get from the multidimensional to the two-dimensional? 2 minutes. Because let me quickly talk a bit more about that space. Because that space, I see that always a bit like a laundry machine. Because, as I said, like the cats live here and there, but like in a laundry machine, let's say you have the red socks that wind around the blue jeans and some of the, I don't know, your scarf ends up in the trouser of a jean. So this space is kind of very intertwined and winded, but still, let's say, all the sock elements are still on a manifold. And the same is that the cats all kind of are in there, but it's not really like a circle or something. It's more like a weird space. And what the training of this neural network does is pretty much tries to untangle this space in a way that it can easily kind of separate between different categories. And so, yes, now we come to kind of that look. And because now we have the problem, we cannot really visualize this multidimensional space. We can only see in 2D, and we can imagine maybe in 3D, or we can imagine. But once it goes higher, we have no idea. But there is this super popular technique now, which allows you to take any multidimensional, let's say, features, multiple, and then boil them down into something we can understand. And that's called T-SNE. And that is like T, stochastic, neighbor embedding. Anyway, you just have to remember T-SNE because everybody uses T-SNE. And it's so nice because, as you can see, you throw in all your classified data and it will nicely create these thematic clusters for you if you have trained your data correctly. And the magic, okay, and that is even better, you can train, you don't even have to train your own model. There are all these pre-trained models that are able to distinguish cats from dogs and cars from houses. And you can run that over any data you have. If you are working with engravings or you are working with something, you can still run that through this neural network. You get the feature vector, and it will create you some meaningful clusters, I promise you. So you don't even have to start training your own. So now when you have this, it's of course, it's much easier to kind of separate certain clusters and improve your training data. So, very quickly, a quick distraction, because you can also do the T-SNE on metadata, or what I did. There's also the Internet Archive, which has uploaded even more images to Flickr. I think it's now 5 million. And they have a little bit of a better tagging system. So let's quickly zoom out. I mean, you will not see much. But so this is what they have is with every image they scan, they also have the category of the book. And it's very, very well tagged. So for every image, you have something like, I don't know, birds, bird of Africa, I don't know, maybe even botany or something. So you have maybe 4 or 5 tags associated with every image. And what I did, I was just then going through all the images, but just taking kind of the co-occurrence of those tags and created this huge relationship maps, which in a way tells me how the world hangs together. That is quite interesting because just by analyzing the metadata, if we zoom in, we get a thematic map of certain topics. Let's zoom in. So I don't know, where did I end up? Okay, can you see this? So, okay, it looks like we are in the insect department right now, but so insects is close to botany, I don't know, and then there, okay, periodicals. So, and that's, okay, well, there are still animals, fishing, let's see, and and this is quite interesting if you are not actually know what you're looking for. You just know a single category, maybe. I don't know. Maybe you are interested in, let's say, Christian antiquities. I don't know if anybody's interested in that. But then you can see, okay, maybe Etruscan art and Greek art and all these tags are related. So you can start diving in and look, okay, these are, might be themes that are related to my field. And so I find these kind of clusters quite interesting, to maybe discover again things that you did not have immediately in your mind. And okay, there's one thing, I mean, if you've never worked with T-SNE, it's a little bit dangerous too, because it sometimes puts things close together which are actually not close together. And that is because of this multidimensional space. It kind of folds it in. And so T-SNE is usually good in a close local area, but not so much if you, so don't put too much value, like if suddenly two concepts lie next to each other, maybe run it again, and sometimes it lands in a different position. Okay, so. Yes, okay, so, but as you saw, you still have these kind of, things where everything is like hairballs clustered together. It's nice, but if you want to present something a little bit more ordered, I wanted to have a way where I can kind of untangle those clusters, so to present it in a nicer grid fashion. So this is why I programmed this little tool called Rastafari. And so here's a typical T-SNE cluster, which is not so well defined. It's based on album covers. And what Rastafari does is kind of, it untangles it into a grid, but maintains the neighborhood relationships, which is actually, I thought that's totally easy, but it turned out to be quite tricky to do. And so the thing, it's kind of like a rubber sheet, and then it tries to unstretch that rubber sheet. And Rastafari has all these ways, like also to give you good layout suggestions. So if you have, I don't know, 5,260 data points, it will tell you that for this number, there's a very nice rect in these proportions. Or maybe there's no rect because you have, then it gives you, okay, maybe you want to try an isometric mapping or something like that. So, let me see, did my click work? Oh yeah, so, but it's quite beautiful to see how this thing makes everything clean. Anyway, another one, and yes, you can also give it different types of rasters. So if you wanted to, you can turn it into donkeys too. But yes, so after using all these various tools, some are automatic, some are kind of manual confirmation, I finally had order in my British Library data. And yes, so then you suddenly get things like, oh, these are all decorative elements, initials, decorative initials, geometric stuff, handwritten notes, musical notes, circular objects. Of course, I mean, I made the categories. That's the whole point. In a way, I don't know what's in there. So whenever I see something like, okay, this is the fifth time I saw something like a skull coming by, maybe I should start a skull category. Or here, variations of objects, colorful prints, obviously, maps, and portraits. And, oh yeah, that was always my little kind of gold nugget. There are all these beautiful decorative papers. So there were only about, I don't know, in 10,000 images, or maybe there's one. So that's always like, oh, I found another one. So that's kind of this thing. But once you have order in there, and that's the interesting part. So once you kind of don't look at a hole of noise, you kind of can start making discoveries in this data. Because sometimes then this thing sticks out, or while if you look at lots of similar things, then something that is, well, is in that category, but is different, like, it's much easier like to suddenly stick out. So I don't know, I'm interested in funny objects, so here this looked like a headphone to me. I think it's a kind of an African headscarf. Or, yes, because I like these 3D objects, so you find these really beautiful profiles. Again, I mean, I'm doing generative art, so I don't know. I guess at some point I have tried also to make these structures, voxels, Superman, early version of Superman. Or yes, hard rock and soft rock. So now we know how this works. But then there are actually like things that are maybe more interesting for you, because what you can also find is plagiarism, for example. So these two things are from two different books. One is from 1864 and the other one from 1885. And someone actually kind of recreated this engraving or carving. The layout is exactly the same, but it's not a copy. So, I mean, I'm not a scientist, but it would probably be interesting to figure out what's the story there. And this is London, and this is New York, Philadelphia. Or you find kind of printing errors. I enjoy glitches. Vandalism, don't know if you can see that. Somebody kind of redraw her with a pen. Or, and that's interesting, like reuse, because I guess like you had these woodcuts, and then you realize, okay, so at some later time, somebody had kind of recut the same thing, and I don't know which one came earlier actually, but so it's definitely the same wood block which was retouched. Talking about retouching, there were in that British Library collection, there are lots of these what is it called, thrilling stories for the masses. That was kind of before movies, and like kind of that was the entertainment. So you had all these kind of stories told in images, but they were very cheaply produced. So they also had to save money. So what they did is, again, early Photoshop where you said, yes, okay, we reuse that, but get rid of the guy. Or, yes, beautiful painting. Get rid of the woman. Or here, she's, I think it's a different mate, yeah. But yes, the vase is the same, the sofa. Or, and I like this one, it's actually quite tricky, so it looks like horses were, like maybe that person preferred to draw architecture, and horses not so much, so yes, reuse the horse, so... Actually, the coach is okay, I guess that was architecture enough, but the horse, nah, it's there. So yeah, and it's quite nice to find these things. Okay, the other thing, of course, I already was talking about these stories that these images tell, is you find these recurring themes across that have been used. Maybe sometimes there are certain, like, yeah, because, well, you had to tell a story in an image, there were certain markers or how you call it, like elements being used, which kind of told everybody, oh, there's something going on. So let me quickly show you a few of the themes that I identified. So let's see. Okay, that's not even a theme, but so for example, women with books, women reading. So that's more not so much a theme, but it's one of those collections I started. So just find all engravings where there are women reading. But then there's nicer things like, we come to that. No, but the observer. I like the observer, for example. So you have these things where, well, usually it's a couple, and then there's somebody watching or listening to them. So, yes, there. Can you see up there? Yeah. So yes, of course, different times. What else? Head on the floor. Oh yeah, that's kind of okay. That's a nice one. Head on the floor. I mean, we don't wear hats anymore, but yes, losing your head or dropping your head is usually saying there's trouble, or if somebody's drunk, or somebody is courting. So, but it's nice. So you can always find, like, head on the floor has a meaning.
So do you manually?
Actually, yes. In this case, Well, in a way, it's semi-automatic. So what I do is I first identify all these kind of, let's say, images that contain situations, because you can quite easily separate those because they are not portraits. There are usually people on it. And then I can try to train a detector on the head on the floor, but it will probably find something, but it will also find a lot of other things. But so... It is a semi-automatic process, but at least you don't have to go through a million images, but maybe just to 10,000. So it's much... I come to that. 10,000 is not a problem. Okay, one more. In a compartment, I mean, that's kind of like trains came up, so suddenly you get into these awkward social situations where's the one that I like? Here, yes. I mean... Nowadays, people annoy you when they talk with their mobiles in the train. And back then, he was kind of eating oranges, so annoying this guy. So, again, quite nice. Okay, and so there are other things. Oh, okay, one last one. Man spreading. So, yes, so I found the man spreading theme, too. So it's quite fun to discover all these, once you are able to, once you make it easy for yourself, you find all these fields you could further look into. I'm pretty sure I missed a lot of them. Similarity, yeah, that's kind of the most powerful tool in this whole process of identifying things, because yes, it really works. So once you have something and you find things that are similar, you usually are already halfway done. And so what I'm doing is I like looking for these things and creating new orders with it, or just presenting them in a nice fashion. So let's say, for example, these rock tools, which if you, I don't know, come across them in an encyclopedia, you probably are not really interested in them, except if you are maybe, if your field of is rock tools. But I mean, if you look at them, somebody must have spent weeks, or I don't know how long it takes to carve or to engrave such a rock. So I'm now started this rock collection, and I'm always happy when I see one. And this way, maybe you can reappreciate the beauty and the interesting shapes that are there. Or this is 24 anonymous profiles. Again, you find all these geological profiles, which, well, are beautiful in itself. And obviously portraits, faces, a lot of them, so I collect them. In this case, oh, we come to that. Yes, well, I have 100,000 of them. And so what you can do, for example, you can, once you have identified the portraits, you can use additional things like, for example, face marker extraction, which in this case, as you can see, it helps me sorting the faces by in the way, like the direction they look. And so I can just go through this face space and order them. And or I can try to detect age and gender. And in this case, I did this for my 41st birthday. I was looking for 44 men that looked like 44. And so I reassembled them this way. Or now we are with the sad girls. This is 16 very sad girls. So, yes. Oh, and actually, that's what I want to show. Okay, there's also a set with desperate men. So there's the other one where they go like, oh, I'm ruined. And it's usually, I don't know, or bad letter. Let's get back to that training thing quickly, because so there is manual confirmation necessary. So you want to build yourself tools which make this whole process as fast and as simple as possible. So, okay, one task I tried to do was like when I had all this folder full of decorative initials, I wanted to figure out if I can actually train it on recognizing what letter it actually is. Because, I mean, it's easy if you have sharp text and this, but these things are kind of very, kind of lots of different element, like shapes and sizes, and sometimes it's just a big picture with a small letter. So I wanted to train a neural network on distinguishing these letter forms. And so what I do is I built me a little tool for my mobile phone or tablet, which is using the Tinder metaphor. So it shows me something and tells me, I think it's a letter A, and if it's not, I swipe left, and if it's right, if it's correct, I swipe right. And this way, and most important thing, you have to have an undo function, because you go really fast at some point. You go like, no, 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 and then, oh, and because once you are going, then suddenly you realize, oh, two times ago there was a letter that was correct. So the undo function is important, but this way you can go through, I don't know, if you are really good, like 1,000 or 2,000 images in an hour or so, and then, of course, it gets better over time. Like, the more it knows, the better its predictions get, so, and that way, I think I manually classified, 2,000 of these letters, and then trained the model, and actually, this is kind of what then the neural network gave me back, and it works astonishingly well. So, actually works so well that when it showed me this, I thought, that's not correct. It told me that's a B. So I went back to the original scan and, oh, it's correct, it's actually a B. So it was better than I was. But there's this whole thing, because, I mean, it was only trained on letters. The thing is, it starts seeing letters everywhere. So I'm getting this connection of objects and things where it believes it is a letter, but it's actually not. So, of course, I found that very interesting and started collecting those. So here's things that look like A's or M's, T's, and that's it. Okay. So, okay, but now, long curve. So, did I put this in here now? Okay, sorry. So, yes, with this whole work I've been doing and sorting things, somehow this got the attention of Google. And so about a bit more of a year ago, I got that great email, I mean, everybody hopes for, where they said like, oh, we saw what you did and we like it. Wouldn't you like to come to Paris and have a talk? Because in Paris, there's the Google Culture Institute, or it's Google Arts and Culture. And well, I don't know if you know it, the Culture Institute works together with museums and collections, I think it's over 1,000, helps them digitizing their materials or kind of with the metadata and everything. So what is there's a database of 7 million artifacts, I think, right now, and which is kind of accessible to everybody. But the nice thing, we're at the lab where I am now artist in residence, is that we can now use the machine learning techniques and well, all the kind of the whole arsenal that Google offers to analyze this data, be it the metadata or the actual image data. So when they contacted me a bit more than a year ago, they asked me, okay, what kind of project would you like to do? So I proposed this project called X Degrees of Separation, which is kind of loosely based on this concept of 6 degrees of separation, where in a way it's this thing where you are really like connected with every other human on the planet over a maximum of 6 steps. So I know somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody else. So whatever. So, and mathematically it seems to be even less than 6 steps. So I was asking, can I do the same thing with artifacts and artworks? So because obviously there are relationships between artworks, and so while you could think, okay, it's, of course, one relationship, it's done by the same artist, it's done in the same time, it's was created in the same geological geographical location, but actually I was thinking, well, metadata is not always 100% correct. Why don't I just go by the visual similarity? And the nice thing is, because, of course, having access to the algorithms that Google uses, I could use the same algorithm that drives Google Image Search, which is, maybe you know it, you have an image, you drag it onto Image Search, and it will tell you all these images look similar. And so I can use that and get actually the feature vector that I was talking about back, and then create these similarity maps. And then, well, I can make these pathways. So I build a graph of certain neighborhood relationships, and it's really like a big city map internally, where I just connect closely connected artifacts together, but then I can ask, how do I get from Dürer's rabbit to, I don't know, Starry Night? And then it will find, it's almost like your navigator in your car. It will find the shortest route to get there. So the first thing I made for them was this installation in the building, which has a touch screen and nice long screens. But when I saw that the concept actually worked, we also realized, oh, we can totally make this into an online online version where everybody can play with it. And so you can actually go there. It's on artsexperimentswithgoogle.com/xdegrees. And of course, I forgot to turn on the internet. is there Wi-Fi? No, let me go.
Wi-Fi.
Sorry for that.
Wi-Fi password. And
excellent.
You go onto a website and accept the conditions and then.
Okay. Sorry. I mean, I can also skip this part if you. I don't know. How am I doing in my time? Am I already?
You can talk as long as you like. We like to listen to you.
All right. Well, then let me quickly try to get this. So it's the HBM hotspot. So.
Go on the website, you accept the conditions,
okay.
And then we see the website of our sponsor quickly.
Oh, okay, so yes. Thank you, sponsor.
It's Fuller Media where we are here.
Okay. Connection successful. I think we're good. Okay, let's try again. Yes, here we go. Okay, so this is how it starts. Well, of course, it first has to load something. But yes, so the principle is simply use... take any two artifacts from the database, and then it will give you back a possible pathway. So let's click this away. So, and because it's a visual connection, I mean, it might not be kind of what you actually expect, but that is what I like about it, because it opens up this whole possibility for serendipity. Because yes, you go from this 233,000-year-old figure to Edgar Degas, and along the way you can see, well, there might be something that you find interesting or want to know more about. I don't know, we take something like two portraits, and what happens is, well, it stays in portrait space, but you can even see like this feature vector seems to have an idea where faces are, how big they are, but in a way, it goes through this multidimensional space. So there's not always immediately, and usually it the similarity is in various dimensions. Maybe it's the shape, it is the color, it might be objects that are on it. I don't know, let's say two masks. So depending on what you take. So you get sitting figures and the material changes. So I find this, it's a very entertaining thing, but let's search for Dürer. So let's see, okay. So this is what the Cultural Institute has on file regarding Dürer material. So, okay, let's take the rabbit and, I don't know, her. And so as you can see now, well, definitely initially it stays within the color scheme, but then it very quickly switches to portraits, based on the algorithm, sometimes it's interesting to watch what happens there, because sometimes it does very little steps in a way, and sometimes very big ones. It's like sometimes it takes the little country roads and then it takes the autobahn to get to the other side of that space. So I don't know, are there any wish lists what you would like to try?
The self-portrait is not in there, probably.
Which self? That's probably not in there. Of course, that's a way.
It's not.
I don't know.
It's not part of Google.
But so I find this approach very interesting also as a tool for discovery. So for example, here you can see, you have the Virgin Mary with the children, and then it stays on, but then it's... So sometimes what you get is even identical pieces which are hanging in different museums, and I don't know how that works. Okay, if it's an engraving, probably it's okay, but sometimes... I don't have a good example here now, but I don't know how it can be that the same painting is in two museums. Maybe it traveled and it was not... It's still in the database. Anyway, so there are these some favorites. Let me quickly go through a few more. So, you can go between anything, photos and paintings. So there's usually this interesting shape morph or shape color. It's not really explainable, but that is exactly the point, because you have this latent space, which is not where you don't have a full idea how it works. This kind of tries to give you an idea how traveling in this space could work. I think I heard that somebody, so let me go to something that I'm actually doing with the things I find, or like how I'm using the material that I find along the way. And there's this very interesting technique called generative adversarial networks. It's not fully, it's not exactly what you would need, but the concept is highly interesting, because in a way you have two neural networks. One network tries to generate images. You can say, for example, one network is the faker. It tries to generate Picasso paintings. And initially it doesn't know anything about them. But you feed in kind of a random vector in there, and by going through the layers, in the end an image comes out, and then it says, see my Picasso. But, there's another network which tries to become an expert in distinguishing fake Picassos from real Picassos. So that one looks sometimes at a real Picasso painting, and sometimes it looks at an image generated by the other network. And it tells then the other network, no, sorry, you were wrong. That's not a Picasso. But sometimes it gets it wrong and says, yes, oh, you were good. But so when the critique network was wrong, it learns what it has done wrong. At the same time, the generator network also learns when it was good or bad. And in a way, both of these networks get better and better over time. And the astonishing thing is that over time, they get really good at producing images in a certain category that you want them to create for you, which then are getting into photorealistic or, I don't know, whatever you like. And so Pix2Pix, I think it was mentioned a while during the last days, is one, let's say, flavor of this type of network. And the great thing about Pix2Pix is that it's very intuitive, because actually what you do, you give it an input that you, you tell it, this is what I will give you, and you give it another image and you tell it, this is what I want you to make out of that. And you can give it any kind of pairs. So in the original paper, what they did is, like, they did this drawing of a handbag and the original handbag, and then it would try to generate. You give it a black and white bitmap of the outlines, and it will start generating this. Or you give it a night image and a day image, and once you start giving it new night images, it will turn it into a daylight image or facades and anything. So once you have installed it and got through all this thing, it's very intuitive to work with, and you can start doing experimentation. And so that's what I did too. So I wanted to train it on generating faces for me. So, and as you look, as you saw, I have this huge collection of faces in my, like, from the British Library, for example. And I also have these face markers, which I used for the similarity. So I wanted to have a system where I just give it these kind of rough sketch of a face, where I say, these are the eyes, this is the mouth, and then it should generate me a face. And so this is then how it looks. So this is, on the left is the input, and on the right is what it actually outputs me. Like, it makes it, and as you can see, I don't have the second one here. Maybe I have, yes. Because initially I only trained it on female faces, I think about 1,000. And then I started increasing the amount of training data. And as this material came from old books, and in old books there's also kind of 80% portraits of men, all the faces started to look very, like, much more male. That was kind of, so the males were dominating. So again, oops. So yes, you go. Oh, no, go away. Sorry, go back. So, yes, oh, we're almost there. So, okay, this is actually, we got stuck at Elvis. So, but yeah, so this is a little bit slow. So you can see still there are a lot of artifacts and things, but this technique has a lot of potential. And actually, I went quite fast, so I didn't put in the others, but you can also train it, of course, on photorealistic faces. And it will generate photorealistic faces. And, well, you could use this now as a search, for example. You could say, well, I would like to have a face. Are there any faces in my database which look this way or which are like this? And then it could help you doing this. Or, of course, for art, you could just go and say, well, I just want to have faces with a third eye. So I can, of course, vary the whole affair. So yes, wow, I went fast. I thought I would have, because that's actually it. But maybe you have questions or so.
Yes, yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm having the feeling that if I've done one thing right, was the choice of the speakers. And I think that was, again, very inspirational and gives... a lot of, broadens the horizon of what is possible and what is not only explicable to, applicable to art history, but also to art. And I think this is, was a very creative input here. And there's a question here already.
Yes.
I could you say a bit of the technical side? If you take networks that were already pre-trained, you build them from scratch, how many levels they have, how many nodes, which software you used, and these kind of things.
Okay, I don't know, should I repeat the question for the live stream? So the question is, if I have trained my own models, or if I have kind of used existing models, and well, and if, like, exactly the architecture. So both. So I used Café as the framework, because that came already with pre-trained models. And my favorite models architecture is GoogleNet. It's kind of modeled on the Inception model. So it has a certain structure. The interesting part is you can start with a model, as I said before, that had been trained on kind of modern data, or really this typical dogs, cats, things. But then you can use this technique called fine-tuning. So what you do is you take the trained model, and then you just, in a way, erase the lowest layer, which gives you the categories, and train it with your own new categories. The benefit of this technique, it learns much faster than if you train the model from scratch. So
is the pre-training something which is appropriate for your purpose?
So in my experience, you can really start from any model, like even if it has been trained on something else, like if you are dealing with images, and it will very quickly still give you very good results for what you want, because in the end, images have, like, the top layers of these neural networks usually look for the same elements, like edges and maybe colors. Okay, let's say you dealing with just black and white data, then probably it will at some point ignore whatever colors and maybe get a little bit more detail in certain structures. But I usually always use this fine-tuning technique, and because really you can, instead of training for a model for, I don't know, 5 days or a week, usually after a night of training, I already get very good results that work for my purposes. Of course, there's always this thing. These models are never 100% correct. So I would say if you get 95% correct, well, then you're really lucky. So you can really never fully trust what the model gives you back. So that's why I always, before I add something, let's say I want to increase my categories, I always manually reconfirm. Like I look at the images and say, yes, this is really, I don't know, a letter A or... I don't know, a situation. So I never trust the network. Because even if it's 95%, then 5% of your data is wrong, and you don't want to kind of make your training data dirty. I mean, it doesn't matter if you just present it to something that doesn't relearn. But so manual confirmation is still important, I think. The exact number of layers and stuff, so I actually never build my own architectures. So I never test if, like, adding another layer here or, I don't know, this kind of ReLU or these things gives me better results, because that's what I leave to people who actually know what they're doing. So there are scientists whose only job it is to make these networks better, and I just profit from following them. And when the new paper comes out with a new technique, I just grab that model and see if I can apply it for my own purposes. But yeah.
We have a group here that calls itself the Similarity Group. I'm sure there are questions from them.
I guess one technical point on using these models that are trained on photos. Normally, training on photos, there's this data augmentation step before where you say, okay, I have photos of a car. But actually, I can swap the colors around, I can increase the brightness and the contrast, I can mess around with it as much as I want. This is still a car, and so I want to be completely resistant to these kinds of shifts. It seems to me that when working with cultural data, the precise, for instance, pigmentation, the precise contrast, the precise, and so on and so forth, is very important, which is why they've been digitized, often in such a controlled way. Do you explicitly correct for this, or do you just say, probably it will be... learned in the model implicitly?
Well, no, I don't correct for this. I would not do all this data augmentation. So when I trained it on letters, the only augmentation that's done is kind of what's it called, sisling, like you take random crops, but I would never change the colors or things, because working with these engravings and the black and white data, I didn't see the need for it. It worked just that way. But of course, I don't have anybody that I have to prove it to. I just do it for myself, and for me, it's good enough. And I got results. I don't know. I think for the British Library, I myself tagged about 300,000 images this way. So of course, now everybody can use the tag. So it worked. I mean, if you have special needs for a certain project, you might have to be careful there. But usually, it really depends on the material. I mean, did that answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Justin?
Just out of curiosity, do you come from a computer science background?
I come from a entirely self-taught background. So I grew up with computers. I had my first one when I was 12 years old, and...
Commodore 64?
Well, it was actually before Commodore 64. So the Commodore 64 was actually my first real one. That other was a programmable calculator. Anyway, so, and I always wanted to do something with visuals and computers. But when I was done with school, I could have gone to art school, but I can't paint. And I wanted to... So there was no field where you could do graphics with computers, and there was no internet, so maybe at the MIT or so they would have done that already, but I was missing that information. So I kind of grew up with technology, and so the internet came, you could suddenly do these things, and then I just learned everything on the go. So machine learning, I'm pretty much, like this way, the neural networks, I'm pretty much only doing since Deep Dream came out, because that gave me the motivation to finally learn it. I mean, and of course now this field is exploding. So.
Are people doing this with 3D data?
I have not done it with, what kind of 3D data?
Like you, one could imagine that a museum of paleontology with a billion shells would use it to sort fossils and find new spatial connections.
You could do it. I mean, the problem is, of course, nowadays still is the memory capacity of these GPUs. So you would have to find a good way how you encode the data. Maybe for initially it would be enough to use a depth map. So in a way you get just a bitmap of the depths, and then you, or you encode multiple, but you could do it, definitely, and people have worked, like especially with depth maps, you can definitely do something. Otherwise, you always have to find a good format how you encode your data so the neural networks can analyze it, but definitely possible, yes.
Thank you for a wonderful talk.
Thanks.
Thank you, very inspiring. So one question that I have is like when you showed us the book page, you said like the network said that this is a bee,
yeah,
and you had to go back to the original source to confirm it. Is it possible to have like one sheet with several of such paintings / letters and have them all simultaneously, like parallel detection, and still keep the sheep as their common ground, so to speak, or does it always divide it into the entity where it's things that say letter?
So in this case, it's just the way that they are cut up is simply the way the mechanical curator bot was doing it. So the British Library started with a full page scan, which is always available. So in a way, it's up to you what kind of questions you want to ask the document in how you want to prepare the data. So the metadata where this thing is located on the page is still there. So let's say you have a certain, like the model tells you, okay, I found all these elements on this page. Well, you would write yourself a tool which then reassembles all the various sources of information so you get what you want. It's definitely possible. I mean, it's in this case, it's just more convenient for the model to ignore all the text around it. I mean, sometimes the model, that bot also cut the images wrongly. So that you always have to deal with errors there. I mean, there's usually data is never clean. So that is something you always have
all
to learn.
All learned in the last days.
Yes. I mean, that is kind of the first thing you learn, that you just have to deal with it and find ways. Also, the other thing is categories are never clean, right? So once you start a categorizing system and you think it's brilliant, after 2 days you will figure out, where do I put this? It's here and here, so probably tagging is still the best way, because then you don't have to decide, because you can just add more and more data. So, yeah, but I mean, I'm not a scientist, so I just learned it the hard way, and this is so in the end, being able to program your own tools, I think, is my best recommendation I give you. And it's not that, oh, really, it's not that hard. I recommend Python nowadays. I find it very intuitive. And no, seriously, it's because then you are not dependent on what other people kind of give you to use, and you can build your own functions. It's not that difficult to these tasks that you have to do. I mean, let's say cropping, cutting out, finding things, throwing things into a neural network, getting data out. It's most of the things have been solved. All you have to do is put together the Lego pieces. So
it's totally true, but they are laughing because yesterday someone said exactly the opposite.
Oh no, seriously. Oh, what
he said? He said leave Python to the IT guys and care for the rest.
Okay, well, I mean, then the IT guys tell you, oh, sorry, it's not possible, where you in the
yeah.
end it is possible.
Yeah. We had this discussion, but what you are showing us is a certain playfulness. And you say just try and see how far you get and see what's coming out of it, and don't think so much in the beginning, just do it.
Yeah,
and that's a very good attitude. Yeah,
I think that shows the dialectic quality of
principle we have here that also opinions which are quite the opposite can.
I don't claim to have the truth, so definitely.
The other thing I just want to ask is this Google experiment, is it completely visual or is there also a textual metadata?
I mean, we have the whole metadata, of course, but this is purely working on that 128 dimensional feature vector. That is the surprising thing, kind of like how, like what kind of things it sees and what kind of similarities. And so, I mean, yes, this is probably the best trained model. I don't know, maybe there are others, but it's probably one of the best trained kind of models of this kind in the world. Because, of course, Google has all the access to the data, and so, well, that's kind of, let's say it's the state of the art in comparing images to each other. But yes, it's, again, it's not, has not specifically been trained on art. So maybe if you are in a very special field, you want to definitely train your own model to rather get other similarities or other, yeah, relationships.
You were talking about Picasso and that the algorithm can distinguish between an original and a digital forgery.
So. Well, that was more a metaphor. yes, but in theory...
But still, in theory, that is possible. And we could say, as art historians, this is exactly what connoisseurship is about. Mm. So one could say, I'm not saying that, that the computer replaced the art historian. What I'm saying is actually, and this is a big question also in this group here, how much does an art historian need to understand those algorithms and build such software themselves for their own needs? Or in other words, is the art historian no more the person who needs the connoisseurship, but needs to have exactly those IT skills in order to use the computer for his purpose? What would you say?
I think you don't have to have the IT skills. You can, like, if you have somebody who builds you the tools. But I think it helps if you... Okay, maybe it helps if you get a mathematical or kind of a rough idea of what is actually going on there and why certain relationships or why the machine thinks it's similar or not. Or so you can also see the limitations or... Because, I mean, maybe you just... It gives you certain, knowledge back, but it doesn't make sense or... So, and understanding kind of how these models transform whatever you give into something else is helpful. And of course, that requires also a little bit of coding skills, but maybe I always think having a broad knowledge over various, not just knowing a little bit of something is always better than just saying, no, I don't have to know this. So, because also I think it might give you new ways of looking at a problem, or usually I think as a programmer, of course, when you have a task that you want to solve, you have to divide it into little tasks, you have to analyze it first, so it is a certain way of thinking about, anything. So, and having that mindset, I guess, I think helps to in any other task. It might also make you grumpy, like me, when there are certain things just don't make sense how they are done, but, and so yes, again, having some coding skills, you don't have to be an expert, is definitely, I think it should be taught in school. I don't know if it gets taught in school now, but I think they learn how to do Excel or so. But they should really learn one programming language, a simple one, just so you learn the general concepts.
Okay, you all learn Python.
Yes, Python is definitely the most accessible one, and it has all those, it's really like Lego. You need a certain technique, you just write one line of code, import something that extremely brilliant, hundreds of people have worked on, and you get it for free, kind of the knowledge of the world, and you can just play with it. So that's the fascinating part. It doesn't cost a thing, it's free.
More questions? You said you are still a Google fellow?
I'm an artist in residence at Google, so it's kind of a part-time position. So I'm once a week, I'm in, not once a week, once a month, I'm for a week in Paris, and then I work remotely from here, but at the same time I'm also doing my own personal projects. So that's, and yes, so actually the interesting part about the lab is, I mean, we are all kind of this mixture of creative coders, engineers. It lacks a little bit on the, let's say, on the academic side. Let's say that's an invitation. So we are always interested in interesting questions or problems to solve. So if you, we want to have a dialogue where we can see, like, how can we help each other? Like, you have some maybe machine learning problem or something else. You have a collection. And so there's definitely open doors for everybody who just wants to say, okay, well, I'm interested. I have this research and maybe... So it's a very interesting place to be right now.
Mm-hmm. I think so. And I think there's we have much in common because... We do a digital art history, and we do we have a group here that is somehow at the intersection of art and technology, and I think that would be a nice match. And as far as I know, Google still has a cultural institute headquarters in Munich as well.
I think they have kind of like a few people in Germany. I think in Berlin or in Munich, it's possible. But the main kind of the part is in Paris.
All right. Good. But any other question?
Well, he will still be around for some while if you have some more questions. So, but right in the moment, thank you very much. Thanks for the inspiring talk.
Thanks for.